In search of greener grass, riding from reality towards dreams and finding fulfilment, by me, Graham Field. For Mum, who always encouraged the travel and withheld the guilt trip. Whatever you do will be insignificant, but it is very important that you do it. Mahatma Gandhi. Whether you think you can or whether you think you can't, you're right. Henry Ford. Another town I've left behind, another drink completely blind, another hotel I can't find. Lemmy, Motorhead. A refreshingly cynical and humorous account of a solo overland motorcycle journey from England to Mongolia and beyond. Acknowledgements. I've been riding and writing for over 25 years. This book as a result of both. I would like to thank Lauren for believing I could do it, Sarah for helping me to do it, and Sam Manicom for all his support once I'd done it, and Bridget for everything else. And as for everybody else who contributed to my good memories, the internet information contributors, the informers, the travellers, homeowners, helpers, waivers and lookers, thanks for making my view of the planet's people mostly positive. Long may it last. Finally, thanks to you, the listener. Right, what's next? Introduction. And after the break, you're going to find out something else about this gentleman. He wants to make a long journey on a motorbike. Have a think about where he might like to go. And if you can come up with the answer, we'll give you congratulations. Said Noel Edmonds, before the commercial started for the viewing public. The makeup lady waited, with her brush poised, to ply yet another layer of crud to my face. The sound man came and fiddled with my microphone, and the motivational production crew told me to be more appreciative, give more consideration to the money the banker was offering me. It's a lot of money to some people who watch. Don't disregard it. It's a tactic, I lied. If I don't look excited by it, he'll up the offer. I wondered if the banker could hear me. And we're back. With a significant sum of money, the big journey you want to do is to Mongolia. Mongolia? Why Mongolia? Prompted Noel. I clearly knew nothing about it. But then that's why I travel, to find out. Research has never been my strong point. I babbled something about it being a wild country. A challenge and adventure from the start. And how much would a trip like that cost? Oh, I don't bloody know. I would need a specific bike. I couldn't do it on a street bike. Well, I'm committed now, I thought. I've just told a nation of Deal or No Deal fans and all my friends who are watching. I cringe when I think of my response as to why I'd want to ride my bike to such a place. In my defence, they want sound bites, not long-winded explanations. I'll save that for the audiobook. So I was briefly a TV star, recognised everywhere from Marks and Spencers to Asda. Even the local press called for a story. Then, in 10 days, I went from celebrity status to white trash. I rented out my house to save for my trip and moved into a trailer. Man, did I pick a cold winter to live in what, I would explain to anybody, was not a caravan, but a 30-foot-long American fifth-wheel trailer. The sort the caravan club frown upon in their reverse snobbery ways. But I wasn't living in it to make friends in the caravan community. I was there to live a comfortable and compact life for a year. And I did, until the winter of 2009-2010 decided it was going to break records and freeze my tooth brace in its tube. I was preparing myself for the hardships of the road, saving money, and sitting in a poorly insulated freezing trailer. I read my guidebooks and formulated a plan whilst wearing a woolly hat and fingerless gloves. It was never meant to be a return trip. I couldn't even imagine getting there, let alone coming back. Ulaanbaatar was where I was heading. That was my goal. Just that. It's massive. End of story. My budget was £5,000. 100 days at £50 a day. I wasn't sure how realistic it was. It wasn't a holiday, but it wasn't an endurance test either. Some days you want a hotel and a good meal, and some days there's nothing to eat and everywhere to camp. I thought it would even itself out. On reflection, there was a major flaw in my plan. Mongolia was an unthinkable distance, unimaginable terrain, and quite possibly an unachievable destination. But should I actually get there, then what? Next time I do a one-way trip, I'll try and make sure my destination is a port, not a landlocked city in the middle of a landlocked country, in the middle of the biggest landmass on the planet. Ho-hum, you live and learn. Part of the motivation to go was that my social life had gradually disappeared and no longer existed at all. Everybody seemed to be getting partners at the same time. They were all staying at home, playing happy families. There was usually a divorcee around who wanted to catch up on the fun they'd been missing out on. And I was Mr. Good Time, Mr. Commitment Free and Unattached, always up for anything. But there's been a lot of time alone recently, and if I was going to be in my own company, it may as well be out on the road. I steered my life in this direction. It was time to go and take advantage of it. I knew it was getting bad when the doorbell rang one morning and it made me jump. The postman had just brought another eBay purchase to my door. Yep, when the ring of the doorbell is unfamiliar, it's time to go out of that door and close it behind you. Inspired by the long way round? Was I? I don't think so. Mongolia was first brought to my attention in China when I met a Dutch couple who had ridden the Trans-Siberian Express. Listening to their tales of wild horsemen and staying in traditional canvas-covered felt-lined gurs, that was the seed. It germinated on an 11,000-mile ride to the Arctic Circle in Alaska. So I never wanted to even mention the long way round. And I refused to cast judgment on what they did until I had done it too. But Ewan and Charlie are, regardless of opinions, and there are many, as associated with Asia overland as much as Borat is with Kazakhstan. So I couldn't and wouldn't ignore what they did. As my trip progressed, I learnt just what talented actors they are. It was probably 2005 when I saw that series. I watched it again in the May of 2010 for research. Ooh, I thought, we have the same panniers. And that's where the similarities ended. And then the butterflies began. How the hell am I going to manage that on my own? The most challenging ride to date had been the Arctic Circle. Years ago, I decided to get a big piece of art tattooed on my back. I considered this for many years. Every time my top was off, I would think, now, if my back was tattooed, would that be a problem? After years of the answer being no, I started to save and look for a suitable tattoo artist. I considered techniques and design, and I thought about colours and textures, size and time limits. After much consultation with the tattooist I chose, the day came when the design had been agreed and the entire outline had to be tattooed in one sitting from my shoulders to my coccyx. As the needle first penetrated the skin around my kidneys and later over my shoulder, I realised the one thing I'd failed to consider in all my research was the bloody pain factor. I was wondering if I would find the same thing was happening again when I hit the road. The roads would become horrendous, and I know that picking up my fully laden bike single-handed would be next to impossible. Removing luggage every time would be infuriatingly tedious, but I'd deal with that when I had to. For now, making it to Ukraine would be an experience. Riding into Russia would be remarkable. Negotiating the roads of Kazakhstan would be a daunting challenge. And if I did make it to Mongolia, it would be a massive achievement. I was not sure what I'd do when I get there. I'd see if anything was broken, bike, budget, or body. And if everything was intact, then maybe I wouldn't turn around. But that was a big maybe. Right, there's this monkey. It's a stuffed toy. Yet it's more than a stuffed toy. Monkey is a very significant character. He played a co-starring role in my TV game show. For the last 3 years or so, I made picture books of Monkey having adventures, which I would then video myself reading and send to my daughter in America. The idea was that she would become familiar with English scenes from the book, so that when she came for her first visit, it wouldn't all seem so strange to her. It also served the purpose of teaching her to recognise my voice, accent, and know what I look like. So eventually, Monkey evolved from a toy into a character. The stories always ended with him getting into trouble, and so the catchphrase, "Oh, Monkey, he's so bad," was born. I managed to find another monkey on eBay, who was going to be a stunt double, but when he arrived, although identical in every way, he was half the size. He became Monklet. That led to poignant storylines about how much fun Monkey would have with Monklet and how much he missed Monklet when they weren't together. In my idle hours, I had made a crash helmet for Monklet out of a tennis ball. It was matte black and open-faced with a silver chain for a chin strap. My friends said I had too much time on my hands. Perhaps. Just think of all those trips to Matterland and episodes of Strictly Come Dancing that I missed out on. Whilst packing the bike, I have moved Monklet around, but there was no room to take him. It was unnecessary and impractical. He had a permanent cheeky smile on his face. I may have been 44, but it kind of warmed my heart to see it. Particularly as he had become a common bond between me and my daughter when we spoke on the phone. "So, how's Monklet doing?" Madeline would ask. "Oh, he's so bad. You'll never guess what he's just done." So at the 11th hour, Monklet was strapped on the spare tyre with a bungee cord. And whilst it may have been the pressure from the elastic, I still think his smile got a little bigger. I was leaving for Mongolia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.